ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जायामुद्धीरये नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया। भगवतीरुत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। नमो पंकजनाभाय नमो पंकजमालिने नमो पंकजनेत्राय नमस्ते पंकजांग्रे। ओम अज्ञानतिमिरंधस्य ज्ञानांजनाशलाकया चक्षुरोन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः। मूकं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंगयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुदीनतारिणं परमानंदमाधवं श्रीचैतन्यमीश्वरं। नमाओं विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्णा चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैता गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। वी वेलकम ऑल डिवोटीज एंड पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू आवर फोर्थ सेशन ऑन द टॉपिक ऑफ स्पिरिचुअलिटी मूविंग फ्रॉम प्रैक्टिकल टू पर्सनल। And we are discussing the case study of Dhruva, who allowed the Lord to direct his life and he surrendered completely to the Lord's desire. So we'll continue with the Dhruva Maharaj's prayers and then we will conclude the seminar with something practical on being personal. In a sense, we want to move our life from leading or from being obsessed with being practical, we want to become personal with relationship, in our relationship with God. But still, personal relationship with God is an abstract concept for many. So we'll discuss some practical steps to move out of practical obsession and live a life of personalism. So Dhruva, he has now offered a beautiful contrasting prayer. Initially, he was obsessed with wanting a kingdom greater than his great-grandfather. And now he's telling the Lord that, my dear Lord, Nyunam Vimushta Mataya Stava Maya Yate, your Maya has influenced a person, a foolish person. Etvam Bhava Peha Vimokshanamanya Heto. One who has come to you and is asking for something other than service to you. Archanti Kalpakatarum Kunapopa Bhogyam. He is a foolish person who's trying to enjoy a dead body. So this is the graphic contrast that Dhruva Maharaj is giving. And therefore he's saying that Ichchanti Asparshajam Niraye Pindranam, a person who desires to enjoy sense gratification, he is a foolish person because he is desiring something which is available to animals and in hellish existence. So Dhruva is made a very big leap, you know, from the zone of sense gratification. He has entered the zone of struggle, and from the zone of struggle, he has entered the zone of surrender, where he has given himself completely to the Lord's will. So now he's contrasting the desire for sense gratification with the desire of living our life as an expression of surrender to the Supreme Lord. He says in a very beautiful prayer, Yane vritis tanubratam tavapada padma dhyanat bhavad gunakata shavane navasyat. स ब्रह्मनिस्व महिम्नि अपिनातमाभूत किं त्वन्तकासि लुलितात् पततां विमानात्. He's saying, my dear Lord, one who gets attracted to you, yāne vṛtis tanubṛtām tava pāda padma, your lotus feet has got nectar. So one who is hearing about your pastimes, the nivṛtis, the joy that he experiences, that is incomparable to anything material. Now, we may be interested in sense gratification and we may think the pleasure we experience through bodily connection must be very high. But Dhruva is saying that when we hear about you and remember you, in contrast to that, everything is insignificant. Dhyanat bhavat gunakata shravane navasyat. In the joy of meditating upon your form by hearing about you, nothing comes close. In fact, the joy of remembering you and hearing about you is so high that sa brahmanishva mahimni apinatamabhu. The joy of Brahman realization, we discussed in our second session, on the joy of seeing Krishna in every aspect of our life. So that Brahman aspect, which is one of the three aspects of realizing the Supreme Absolute Truth, Dhruva is saying that highest happiness in the material world, everyone wants Brahman happiness. But he's saying, Sa Brahmanishva Mahimni Apinata Mahabhut. It is as if, in compared to your glories and hearing about your glories, Sa Brahmani, the happiness of Brahman is as if it doesn't exist at all. That's how powerful and glorious is direct hearing and remembering you is. So if, now then Dhruva contrasts it. He says, if the highest joy of merging with Brahman, which is the goal of the impersonalist school, if that is non-existent in comparison to remembering your beautiful form and your pastimes, if that is a situation of Brahman realization, then what will be the state of someone who is seeking heavenly pleasures? Kim antakasi lulitat patatam vimanat. He's saying, vimana, those who fall from the airplanes, which means those are enjoying in the heavenly planets, the denizens of heaven who roam around in beautiful planes. Kint antakasi lulitat, their pleasure will be broken by the sword of time. So if the denizens, so he's saying the remembrance and connection with the impersonal aspect of the Lord is non-existent. And if that is non-existent in comparison to hearing about Lord, then heavenly pleasures is, there is no discussion, that it is just not in the agenda, it just cannot come in the picture. And for you and me, we need to understand, if Dhruva is saying heavenly pleasures are non-existent in comparison to Brahman realization, and Brahman is insignificant and non-existential in relation to the remembrance and hearing about Krishna, then if all this is the case, then what is the situation of those who are trying to enjoy sense gratification on bodily platform in this material world? It is ridiculous. I mean, it's just doesn't exist. It's the lowest kind of pleasure. And this is spoken by somebody who has realized. Dhruva did not speak this when he was in the forest before the Lord appeared. Now, this is his realization. After the Lord has appeared, he's expressing this realization. In fact, now he's giving us, we may say, when we hear all the Dhruva's prayers, we may say, okay, now how can I experience this? In the sense, we may also want to experience the joy, the highest happiness, right? So how can I experience the highest happiness which Dhruva has experienced? So Dhruva is giving us, Dhruva Maharaj is giving us a method. He's saying, oh, we can also experience if we do something very important. And that is the next verse where he's saying, this is also one of the landmark verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam, where Dhruva is teaching us the method of experiencing complete happiness of surrendering to Krishna. Bhaktim muhu pravahatam tvai me prasango bhuyadananta mahatam amalashayanam enanjasolbanamuru vyasanam bhavabdim neshe bhavad gunakatam vritapanamattah. My dear Lord, I want to become mad. This is the prayer Dhruva is offering, that he wants to become mad. Mad for what? Bhaktim muhu pravahatam tvai me prasango. Prasanga, Srila Prabhupada translates, means intimate association. Dhruva Maharaj is not simply asking for association. He is asking for intimate association of who? Bhaktim muhu pravahatam. He is asking for intimate association of those people who are living in continuous association of Krishna Katha. Those who are continuously rendering devotional service, I want intimate association of such people. So Dhruva Maharaj is asking for that blessing which is freely available to most of us in ISKCON. We are getting devotee association all the time. And Dhruva is asking for this benediction. Bhaktim muhu pravahatam tvai me prasango bhuyadananta mahatam amalashayanam. I want association of those devotees who want to free their heart of all mala, all contamination. Those who are aspiring to the pure, I want their association. And in that association, what will happen? Enanja solbanamuru vasanam bhavabdim. I can easily cross over this terrible ocean. Ulbanam means terrible. Enan jasol banam uru, great ocean. Ulbanam uru vyasanam bhavabdim. Abdi means ocean. Bhavabdi, the ocean of material existence, which is terrible, which is huge, which has ferocious aquatics. I can cross over this ocean if I have intimate association of those devotees who are absorbed in devotional service. Neshe bhavad gunakatam vritapanamattah. And that solution or that way, method by which I can cross over this ocean, is to hear and chant your glories, my dear Lord, in the association of your wonderful devotees. And therefore, I want to go mad in that association. I want that association in which I can go mad hearing about you. So this is Dhruva Maharaj's amazing prayer after having initially desired something purely material. So this means, if we have the blessing of association of devotees, if we are blessed with opportunity to hear about the Lord and chant about the Lord and read Bhagavatam, that means it is not material. That means we have been given a spiritual blessing. That means we have embarked on the journey of spirituality. The fact that this is what is desired by Dhruva after he is completely purified. When Dhruva is standing in front of the Lord, he is asking for a benediction which is freely available to all of us. So therefore, this is the highest blessing. And now it's up to us to make the best use of it. In fact, Dhruva says that if we actually make the best use of the process of hearing and chanting, then the reward that awaits us is tena smarantatitaram priyamisha martyam echan vada suta suhud grihavitta dara etvab janaba bhavadiya padaravinda saugandhya lubdharudaye shukrita prasanga. He says, my dear Lord, if someone gets connected to you, tena smaran, he will never start remembering atitaram premisha martyam. If he is attached to you, then he will not be attached and he will not remember bodily relationships, bodily attachment. In fact, ye chan vadaha suta suhurt grahavitta dara. His attachment to body, house, opposite sex, wealth, position will all fade away because his heart is filled with remembrance of your lotus feet. Therefore, it is important, my dear Lord, that one gets attached, one gets attracted to your devotees who glorify you, because your devotees carry you in their heart. So when they talk, they are emitting the fragrance that is coming from your lotus feet. Etu abjanaba bhavadiya padaravinda. Abjanaba means the Lord with the lotus navel. Saugandhya lubdha hrudaye shukrita prasanga. So devotees who glorify you, they are glorifying you because they are experiencing the fragrance that is coming from your lotus feet. Saugandhya lubdha hrudaye shu. And their heart is filled with love for you. So when they talk, they are emitting that fragrance. They are emitting that love which is there in their heart, which is there because of remembrance of your beautiful pastimes. So I want that association. And in that association, I will go mad remembering you. And this is the greatest benediction. So from a person who wanted a kingdom, who wanted material opulence, his desire now is to simply sit and hear about Lord Krishna. And now he says that what a fool I was, that I was asking for so many material things earlier. Aho bata mamanatmam mandabhagyasya pasyata bhava chiddha padamulam gatva yache yad antavat. Aho, aho means alas. Mamanatyam, look at my fallen condition, my dear Lord. Manda bhagyasya, look how unfortunate I am. Manda bhagyasya, pashyata, just see my condition, my dear Lord. That I came to you, bhava chidda padamulam. One who remembers the lotus feet. He can break attachments to material world, but still, gatva yache yad antavat, still I came to you asking for perishable things. One who comes to you will be given eternal blessings, but I'm a fool, I came to you. I could have got eternal blessing, but I'm asking for perishable things. Oh, how foolish I am, how unfortunate I am. Now, when we read this prayer of Dhruva, we need to be careful. We need to remember that Dhruva is offering this prayer not as a practice. It's not that he is chanting this prayer so that, you know, Lord will appear before him. No, the Lord has already appeared. He has chanted Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. No, we chant Hare Krishna. So that the Lord appears. So that the Lord gives us a taste. And once a devotee experiences that presence of the Lord and his heart is filled with so much love, that automatically this kind of prayer comes out, where he is condemning himself as unfortunate, as foolish, as ill-advised, as terribly fallen. This is not to be imitated. We can't go to Krishna and say, Krishna, I'm so fallen. Krishna, I'm so degraded. What happens is the subconscious mind takes only the fallen degradation. The negative self-talk gets registered in the mind. Therefore, before we condemn ourselves, because right now we are working on Sambandha, we are trying to establish a relationship with Krishna. A relationship is not established as yet. So in the process of establishing a relationship, it's better we present ourselves positively and cheerfully in front of the Lord. And let us be situated on a platform of confidence and cheerfulness, not unrealistic and unnatural self-condemnation. Dhruva is saying out of great joy, it's just pouring out. When you're in ecstasy and you condemn yourself, that's perfectly bona fide, because that's, you have no control. It's just coming out of your heart, which is filled with love. When our heart is filled with pain and suffering of material world, and then when we condemn ourselves, then we attract more negative forces. Therefore, we need to be careful. Dhruva is revealing in the next verse that, you know, there is something called as duality. This world, we constantly live in fear because bhayam dvitiya binivishatasya, because we are affected by duality of victory, prasuptaiva binna druk. My dear Lord, the fact that I considered my brother as my enemy, Dhruva Singh, because he wanted a kingdom, he wanted to be better than his brother. He says, Bratr, Bratr, I considered my own brother as an enemy because tapye ditiye. I was affected by the duality, and that is because of your illusory energy. I was seeking material benedictions. Therefore, I have unfortunately taken shelter of your illusory energy. Prasupta, it was as if I was in a sleeping condition. Now I have woken up. Now I can't afford to think like this. I can't be in this negative mindset. I know many people who have been affected by certain addictions, and they were not able to get out of their addictions because they were trying to avoid some problem, but because of feeling bad and constantly condemning themselves as fallen for being so fallen, they attracted that very situation that they wanted to avoid. Like if somebody is into drugs or alcohol, and he's then condemning himself as fallen. Oh, I'm addicted to alcohol, I'm addicted to drugs, I'm addicted to pornography. So somebody is addicted to these things and he's feeling bad about it and he's condemning himself that he's fallen. Then what happens is that negative self-talk that I am fallen. See, there is a difference between having an addiction and being an addict. You are not an addict. You are a wonderful human being who has an addiction. But unfortunately, what happens is we take it so personally. We take our problems so personally that we identify and we merge our identity with our addiction and our problem that our consciousness becomes one with it. So when I say I'm fallen, I'm not good, I actually, that becomes me rather than I having an addiction or a problem. That problem becomes my identity, and that is not the best way to come in front of Krishna. We come in front of Krishna in a pure state, in a state of joy, of Satchit Ananda, the state of soul. The state of surrender is Satchit Ananda, pure, eternal, blissful soul. That's not a state of condemnation. So when we can see, so if I'm addicted to bad things and I wish I don't have those addictions, but if I condemn myself as bad, then I am bad. My subconscious mind registers me, myself, as a bad person. If I'm a bad person, then what should I be doing? Then I should be doing bad things, right? If I am a bad person, then I'll do bad things. And therefore, I will get attracted to that very addiction, which is a bad thing. Because I'm bad, I will do that more. So negative self-talk reinforces destructive behavior. That is the point. So when Dhruva is condemning himself, we need to remember that this is a beautiful prayer of love. So if I'm not able to say that I'm fallen out of love, then don't say that. Focus rather on developing that love for Krishna, glorifying Krishna's beauty. And in that, when Krishna touches the soul, automatically self-condemnation will come. So our goal is to get connected to Krishna. See, when we criticize ourselves as fallen, and when that becomes my primary identity, there is no Krishna, because that is false ego. Therefore, Dhruva is in a different state now. He has been touched by the Lord. He is experiencing the ecstasy of the Lord. Therefore, he says in his prayers, he concludes his prayers by saying, Swarajyam yachato maudyan mano me bhikshito bata Ishwarakshi na punyena palikara nivadana. He says, you are giving me Swarajya, you are giving me your own kingdom. You are giving me connection with you, my dear Lord. Swarajyam yachato maudyan. But look at me, my foolish personality. How foolish I am, my dear Lord. Mano me bhikshito bata, I am like a useless, foolish beggar who has gone to a king. Ishwarat kshina punyena, a beggar who is devoid of all pious credits. When he goes to a wealthy king, what should he ask for? And the king is generous. He is willing to give anything the beggar asks for. But what does the foolish beggar ask for? Ishwarat kshina punyena palikaran ivadhana. He asks for broken pieces of husked rice. Is that what you ask? when you know that your benefactor can give you a kingdom, he can give you his own throne, he can give you residence in his palace, and they're asking for a few pieces of broken rice, khali karan ivadhna. This is my condition. So Dhruva is saying that when we see material benedictions, we are extremely foolish, because the Lord can fill our hearts with so much joy. Dhruva at one time wanted power and position. Now Dhruva is contrasting it and saying it's all useless. Now just like Dhruva, we find in the seventh canto, Prahlad also contrasts this, that he saw his own father having power and position. But he saw that his father was, despite having unlimited power and position, it was all useless. Drishtha maya divivibho kila deshnya panam ayushriyo vibhava icchati anjanoyam yesmat pitu kupitaha savijrimbitabru vispurjitena lulita satute nirasta. Prahlad says a very beautiful prayer. He says, my dear Lord, I have seen it personally. He's saying, Drishtha maya divivibho kila deshnya panam. I saw extremely powerful controllers and gods of this material world. And I saw that these gods are not ordinary. They had long lifespan. Ayushriyo vibhava icchati anjanoyam. They had long life. They had opulences. They had fame. They had beauty. And they could get what they want. But these powerful leaders who had so much power and opulences, when they came in front of my father Hiranyakashipu, they trembled in fear. In fact, yesmat pitu kupitaha sa vijrimbitabhru, when my father would raise his eyebrows, vijrimbitabhru, he would expand his eyebrows in anger, and he would expand it by yesmat pitu kupitaha sa, means angry laughter. Sometimes Hiranyakashipu would sarcastically laugh. He was angry with the devas. He would look at them and he would laugh angrily. And he would raise his eyebrows. And the gods would tremble in fear. These gods who had so much power, position, lifespan, beauty, they would tremble. This is the nature of material world, duality and fearful existence. And Prahlad also compares this and contrasts this. So in this old religious television serials like Ramayana, I remember, the villains, Ravana, Kumbhakaran, any of the Rakshasas, when they had to say something emphatic, they would first laugh. They would laugh loudly, and that means they're very angry. And that is some of the stereotyped television characters. They would laugh. That means they're very angry. So Prahlad, this is coming from Bhagavatam actually. Prahlad is saying, Esmat kupitahasa. My father was angry and he would laugh. Kupitaha sa vijrimbitabhru, and he would raise his eyebrows. And when he would do that, all these great gods, Ayushriyo vibhav icchati, they had so much power, but they would tremble in fear. But the best part is that my father was so powerful that the great powerful gods would tremble in fear simply by hearing my father's laughter. That personality, my father, what was his situation? Vispurjitena lulita satute nirasta. When you appeared simply by your small exhibition of power, patatat nirastat, my father was easily vanquished. He was destroyed by your tiny power. So we have on the one hand great controllers and gods who have so much power, opulence, beauty, etc. And they are fearful in the presence of Hiranyakashipu's mere laughter. And this Hiranyakashipu is easily vanquished by the Supreme Lord. So whom are we connecting to? We have the great opportunity. We are blessed with association of directly the Supreme Lord by chanting his holy name, by hearing about him. And we are giving up that. And seeking material, we are seeking a life in the zone of gratification, sense gratification. So Bhagavatam is appealing to us, come out of this zone and enter the zone of struggle. And if you are already living in the zone of struggle, now is the time to take complete shelter of Krishna and surrender to Krishna. In fact, in another prayer, Prahlad says, he is contrasting this happiness also. Putra shisha shuti sukha mrigatrishni rupa vedam kale varamashesha dujan viroha nirvidyate natu jano yadapiti vidvan kamanalam madhlavai shamayandurape. This is one of the most beautiful prayers. He says, my dear Lord, kutra ashisha, what kind of ashisha, what kind of blessings are we asking for from you? This is what Dhruva is also saying, right? That, my dear Lord, what kind of a blessing I'm asking? I'm asking for blessings of enjoying this body, sense gratification. I want to give it up. I want to be connected to you in the space of surrender, because the blessing that we seek at the bodily level is pathetic. Prahlad says, kutra shisha shruti sukha mrigatrishni rupa. These blessings that we want are shruti sukha. They're very pleasing to hear. You know, when somebody says, may you live a long and healthy life, shruti sukha, that is so pleasing. On your birthday, if somebody says, I pray that you get a huge, opulent, beautiful house as a gift. May you get billion rupees as, you know, some jackpot, some lottery. May you get so much of money. When we hear that, shruti sukha, this is what we love to hear. And if we get those blessings, kutra shisha shruti sukha mrigatrishni rupa, this is Prahlad's verdict, that the blessing that we love to hear about, even if we get it, it is like mriga trishni rupa. It is like a mirage in a desert. So if you're walking in a desert and you see water and you think it is water and you run towards that and you jump there and you realize it's burning sand. But because of the mirage effect, you saw burning sand as water from a distance. And when you jumped, you burnt your body more. So you learned your lesson. Next time, as you continue your walk, and when you see water, you know it is not water. It is mriga trishni rupa. You know it is a mirage. You will be careful, right? Wrong. In this world, we enjoy sense gratification. We get our desires fulfilled. And we burn ourselves. We suffer terribly. Although we got what we wanted. We all wanted to enjoy sense gratification and we got it. But we have burnt ourselves. We have realized it's a mirage. But unlike an intelligent man who realizes it's a mirage and doesn't jump into the sand, we, in our material bodily existence, we again run back to that mirage. So, sense gratification is so powerful. We are trapped in the zone of sense gratification, which is a mirage. Prahlad, Dhruva are telling us, get out of this. It's a struggle, but get out of this. Not only is there a mirage in this material world, the means, the body, which is the main source of our enjoyment in this world, that itself is a source of misery. Kvedam kalevaram ashesha rujan viroha. Kvedam idam, this body, kalevaram, kvedam kalevaram idam, is saying this is ashesha rujan viroha. Ashesha means unlimited, rujan means disease, unlimited discomfort and diseases, viroha. This body is the abode, it is a place which generates unlimited suffering. This body, which is our greatest trump card, this body is what we think will help us enjoy sense gratification. This body is an abode, is a place from which a lot of diseases are created. And then there are sense objects which are like mirage. So we are so disconnected from reality. So Prahlad is saying this body is an abode of misery and suffering. You take a simple example. On one piece of paper, you write down on the left side all the things you could enjoy with this body. Any limb of the body, what are the different ways you could enjoy from your bodily organs? And on the right side, you write what are the different inconveniences, discomfort, or diseases that you can get because of this body. contrast it. See which one is greater. The diseases and pain that we suffer because of this body is much, much, much greater than the pleasure that we can experience from this body. Therefore, Prahlad is saying that, my dear Lord, the sense objects, the joy that they give is a mirage. And this body is an abode of disease. And this simple truth is not understood, realized by not just foolish people, even the most intelligent people in this world, they cannot understand this because they are trapped in the zone of sense gratification. They haven't moved to the zone of struggle or surrender. Therefore, Prahlad is saying, Nirvidyate natu jano yadapi iti vidwan. Vidwan, most learned man, also cannot see that this body is an abode of misery. And why he cannot realize this? Why we cannot understand this? Kamanalam madulavai shamayandurape. Kamanalam, we are burning with the fire of desire. Kama analam. Analam means fire. This fire of lust, which is burning in our heart, madulave, because of this burning sensation, when we get a drop of honey, just a drop of honey that falls on our outstretched tongue as we are being bitten by snakes, rats, and as we are struggling in this well of material existence, that one drop is what gives us relief and succor because we are burning in that fire of desire. Therefore, shamayan, it is to control this is durape, very, very difficult, my dear Lord. It's extremely difficult. So Prahlad and Dhruva are teaching us that it is extremely, it's an insurmountable ocean, this material existence. Therefore, we cannot live in this world of sense gratification, and we cannot struggle also, and we can't cross over it on our own efforts. We need to completely surrender. We need to take shelter of Krishna. And therefore, Srimad Bhagavatam is appealing to us that, and Dhruva is appealing to us, Prahlad is appealing that if we take shelter of the Lord and if we hear and chant about the Lord, then eventually the joy that these great pure devotees are experiencing in the presence of the Lord, that is what we will experience. The joy of hearing and chanting about the Lord is not different than the joy experienced by Dhruva and Prahlad in the physical association of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, Lord Kapila Dev is instructing all of us, Satam prasanga mama vira samvido bhavantirat karna rasayana kata tajoshanada shapavarga vartmani shaddharatir bhaktir anukramishyati. Satam prasangam, in the association of devotees, hear about the Lord's glories. Mama virya samvido bhavanti rit karna rasayana kataha. Let the katha enter, let it, the rasayan means the chemical combination of hearing Krishna katha. That is like the elixir, that is the tonic, that is the magic juice that if we take, the joshanadash apavargavartman, we'll be relieved from the suffering that is imposed on us because we live in the zone of sense gratification. Shraddha ratir bhaktir anukramishyati, gradually faith in the Lord, love for the Lord, attachment to the Lord will eventually come into our lives. So therefore, this is the focus of a sadhaka. Instead of struggling endlessly, we now move from the struggle to the zone of surrender by surrendering to the process of hearing and chanting about the Lord. Surrender to Krishna. Living in the space of surrender means basically just engaging in hearing and chanting. Unfortunately, after some years of practice of bhakti, spiritual practices, we think we have to do something esoteric or something special. There is nothing special to be done. After 25, 50, 75 years of bhakti, we still do the same thing that we did on day one. Hear and chant. But because of our crooked mind, because we are so habituated to live in the struggle space, we look for practical solutions on how to hear. We look for practical ways to make bhakti work. No, sir, there is nothing practical. Just hear and chant. This is it. That's it. And you may say, but I was hearing and chanting on day one, and pure devotees are hearing and chanting. See, is it the same? It's the same externally, but the pure devotees, they are experiencing Krishna's presence in that hearing and chanting. So when we are hearing and chanting, we are chanting at the stage of practice. And when we become proficient in this practice, in that very practice, we will experience God. Tadeva ramyam. Tadeva ramyam. Ruchiram navam navam. Tadeva shashvan manaso mahotsavam. Tadeva shokarnava shoshanam rinam. Yaduttama shloka yasho nugiyate. Tadeva ramyam. Ruchiram navam navam. So when the pure devotees are doing the same activity like a new devotee of hearing and chanting, but they are experiencing ruchiram navam navam, new taste. When I am a new devotee, I am trying to hear about the Lord, I may get bored after hearing the same shloka, the same pastime. But the pure devotee, when he hears the same story, ruchiram navam navam, is experiencing newer and newer taste. Tadeva shashvan manaso mahotsavam. There is mahotsava. There is a great festival in the mind of a pure devotee when he's hearing about the Lord. When we hear the same story, we find it boring. But for a pure devotee, it is manaso mahotsavam. It is a great festival in the mind. Tadeva shokarnava shoshanam ranam. For the living entities of this material world, hearing about the Lord means the ocean of shoka, shokarnavam, the ocean of lamentation becomes dry in an instant. So, you know, we are so sad, we are crying, we are suffering. It's like ocean. Imagine an ocean that dries up in a minute. That's how powerful Krishna Katha is. Tadeva shokarnava shoshanam ranam. Yaduttama shloka yashonu giyate. Therefore, glorify Krishna. And therefore, we are now entering Janmashtami in a few days. And when we are going to celebrate Krishna's appearance by hearing about Krishna's pastimes, at that time, we are going to chant more and more pastimes of Krishna, beautiful stories of Krishna. So we are preparing our consciousness now to surrender to the Lord as we enter Janmashtami. From a life of sense gratification, we have chosen the path of bhakti, spirituality, which is the path of struggle. And while struggling in this path of spirituality, bhakti, we want to understand that this struggle is a bridge in which we are crossing over and finally entering the stage of surrender, where we tell Krishna that, Krishna, I am yours. I simply want to hear about you. I want to glorify you. I want to please your transcendental senses because I have now at last come to you. I don't need anything else. Parija tanjasa labdha saranga anyona sevate vadangri moolam asadhya sakshat kim kim vinimai parijata anjasa labdha saranga. Bumblebee is looking for nectar from different flowers, but finally when it comes to parijata flower, parijata anjasa labdha saranga anyona sevate, it doesn't go anywhere else. He doesn't feel like going anywhere else because Parijata flower gives him all the nectar that he's been looking for. Similarly, just like a bumblebee is completely satisfied after having come to the Parijata flower, my dear Lord, Parijata anjasa labdha saranga nyona sevate tvad angri moolam asadhya. I have come to your lotus feet. Sakshat kim kim vrini mahi. What is the need to go anywhere else now? I'm experiencing the nectar of your pastimes. I'm experiencing the nectar of connection to you. So this is a devotee's prayer, that we want to remember the Lord. We want to connect to the Lord. We want to feel the richness of Lord's love in our hearts. And once that is experienced, that is a beautiful personal relationship with Krishna, which is uniquely special for each one of us. And it is different for each one of us. And once we experience that personal relationship, then all the practical seminars don't mean anything. They may be needed for us to do our things in this world, but the place of action, the place of joy, the place where spirituality is thriving is the heart, the soul, which is filled with union, the joy of union with Krishna. Of course, when we talk about this personal relationship with Krishna, I know devotees will say, but you know, But still we need something practical. You know, how can I develop that love for Krishna? Nothing, my dear friends. It's hearing, chanting and service. And in the zone of surrender. Everything will be revealed. You know, if you go to any military academy, you will see that in military academy, they teach the students about different wars. The Napoleon Wars and the American Civil War, you know, how different generals fought, how they organized their armies, how different battles were won. So in any military academy, different battles are fought. But when an army soldier goes into the battle, he doesn't carry his notebook with him. And when he's in a provocative situation, the soldiers don't look at each other and say, okay, let us implement that particular lesson we learned in that war, from that war. No. Every battle, every war is uniquely different. And a soldier knows it. At the same time, he has studied for 4 years, 5 years, all the wars. And that has developed his intuition. That has made his gut stronger. That has made his sense of discrimination and reasoning stronger. So when he is in a uniquely new war situation, his intelligence is evolved, his sense of discrimination is sharper, and he takes a spontaneous, spur of the moment decision, which then becomes part of another syllabus, which is another war. But each war is unique. Similarly, our situations, each one of us is in a uniquely different situation. And even each one of us, every test is unique. How to pass these tests? Don't depend on some practical tips given by others. Let us discover, based on the guidance of the Lord from within, on that particular battle, at the spur of the moment, let the Lord guide us. Because that's the way things will work and fall in place. You can't copy, paste a solution from another time zone, from another situation into your life, because your purification, your timeline, your karma baggage, your patterns and your mental state is all different. You are a unique blend of mind, intelligence, ego combination. So how you can practically solve your problem is dependent on your surrender to Krishna. Just like each battle is dependent on the general's spur of the moment decision, which is based again on collective, consistent hearing and study of so many battles. Similarly, we consistently hear about so many pure devotees. We hear, we chant, we glorify Srila Prabhupada, we hear Bhagavatam stories, Ambarish Maharaj, Dhruv Maharaj, Prahlad, Gajendra. All these things we hear, we nourish ourselves, but it won't be practical. The practical is, all of this will guide us, the Lord in the heart. Srinatam Sakata Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana Hridayantastu Yavudrani Vidunoti Surasatam. The Lord, He will guide us. The Lord will guide the devotee. Tesham Pratata Yuktanam Bhajatam Priti Purvakam Dadami Buddhi Yogam Tam Yena Mam Upayantite. Krishna assures Arjuna in the Gita that if you sincerely render devotional service of hearing and chanting and service, Dadami Buddhi Yogam, I will give you the intelligence to handle your problem and navigate through the troubled waters of this material world. Just surrender to me, because I will light the lamp of knowledge and clarity. Tesha mevanukam partham aham agyanajam tamah nashayamatma bhavasto jnana deepena bhasvata. Jnana is a deeper light. This light will dispel all darkness if we surrender to the Lord. If we allow and receive anukampa, the Lord's amazing mercy and compassion. So the Lord directs the living entity from within. One of the great saints in India, Eknath from Maharashtra, he was a great devotee of Lord Krishna. And his daughter was married to a man who was a religious devotee, but he got into bad association and every night he would disappear and associate with bad people. So the young wife was very sad. She went to her father, the great devotee Eknath, and told about her husband's late night exploits. So Eknath felt compassion on his daughter and his son-in-law. So he called him and he said, "Can you do me a favor, my dear young man? My daughter is a fool. She doesn't understand scriptures. She doesn't understand Gita. Can you just spend a few minutes every evening and just read a little bit from the Bhagavad Gita? And then you can go and do what you want." So the young man said, "Okay, you oblige this father-in-law." So every evening, he would read the Bhagavad Gita for his young wife. And as he read every day, every evening, and after a few days, the sound vibration, the sound that he was speaking, purified his heart. And he himself realized, and he got the strength, and he gave up this adventure of the night. And he stayed alive. And that's how his heart was transformed. Therefore, instead of seeking ever new practical solutions, let us take shelter of the Lord through the process of hearing and chanting. And we will prepare. This is a preparation for the Janmashtami class that is going to happen now. And we are going to hear about Lord Krishna directly, the pure direct pastimes of Lord Krishna in this mood. Because this is what will guide us. This is what will give us succor and shelter. When we were in Sri Lanka, last year, 2019, February, I had gone with Govind Prabhu for a small yatra. I remember one day I gave a very practical class on mind and relationships, and there were a few people who were very appreciative. And next day I spoke pure direct pastimes from the Yudha Kanda of Ramayana, which is known to everyone. You know, everyone in the Ramayana, from childhood we've been hearing who killed Kumbhakarna, who killed Indrajit, what happened in Ramayana. So I spoke pure pastimes without any additional commentaries or purports, just the story. And I had a different kind of, different group of devotees who came and thanked me. And again, the next day, I gave a practical class. So I saw there were some devotees who were very much happy. They knew that those practical tips, techniques is what they were looking for. And there was another group of devotees who were simply nourished by the pastimes. And I could see that even we have these two personalities to our aspect, these two aspects of personality. We want sometimes very practical solutions, which is needed. But at the same time, we also need to invoke this aspect of a personality, of simply surrendering and just caring for the Lord without any other ulterior motive, without any other agenda. And that's when we will be able to make our life in this material world very happy, peaceful. We will be able to make our struggle, from struggle zone, we'll be able to enter into the surrender zone. Very honestly admit, many of us, when we chant Hare Krishna, we are trying to pull the mind back. The mind is wandering and we are pulling it back. And at the end of it, so I'll conclude with this. So now we may be struggling now in our chanting. Although chanting is the greatest prayer, it is 2 hours of time just spending with Krishna. It's a time when we surrender to the Lord. But we find it so difficult because the mind is dragging us everywhere. Now, I have discovered some simple steps. When I follow them, my japa, the struggle in my japa becomes a much happier experience. I can make, you know, when I follow this principle, I can transform a struggle experience to surrender experience. We have already discussed the difference between struggle and surrender. Struggle is exhausting, but surrender is a sweet, happy experience. So we can make our chanting, hearing, rather than a struggle, we can make it a happy surrender experience. If we simply improve our awareness, and with awareness, if you do 2 things, one is whenever you are aware that your mind has wandered, don't struggle. See, the more we pull the mind back, no, I want to listen to the holy name. I want to hear the class. I want to be sincere. So this struggle of pulling and the mind will rush everywhere. But when we struggle to pull it back, that struggle causes exhaustion. Now, I am proposing, based on what I've heard from my seniors and my worshipable mentors, is that instead of fighting, instead of struggling, why not do these 2 things? First is begin fresh. At that very moment, forget the last 1.5 hours or 2 hours of chanting that you have done. And instead of lamenting that, oh, I've struggled so much, my mind is wandering so much. Don't struggle now. Just begin fresh. Begin as if you are starting now. If you are to start now, then your 2 hours of past chanting or 1.5 hours of past chanting, it didn't happen at all. You are just beginning now. Begin fresh. That is one. Second, whenever you see your mind is wandering, instead of struggling to get it back, do the second thing, which is come back gently, gently and graciously. Just be gentle with yourself. Take it easy. When we do that, we'll experience that Krishna consciousness is a very happy experience. And we can experience the joy of surrender. Unfortunately, right now, even when we pray, as I was explaining yesterday, it is the mind talking to itself. In fact, when we live in only in the struggle space, we will eventually slip, believe it or not, from the struggle space, unless we surrender to the Lord completely. If we don't surrender to the Lord, we will surrender to our mind and senses. We will slip lower because the happiness of the soul is experienced only in surrender to the Lord. Happiness is not experienced in struggle. Struggle will leave us exhausted. In fact, the soul is hankering for rasa, and because that rasa is not experienced in our mind and intelligence and senses because of the constant struggle, we will be dragged again to the lower pleasures and sense gratification. In fact, the mind, we will take shelter of our mind, which promises us happiness of sense gratification. You know, just like, you know, sometimes when the terrorists, they capture a person, the person starts thinking after some time that the terrorist is his well-wisher. In psychology, this is called as a Stockholm syndrome. In Stockholm, once the terrorists attacked a bank and held all the people inside the bank as captive hostages, and they were negotiating with the government, and these hostages, at one point of time, they all became sympathizers with the terrorists. Although their lives were in danger, they would have been killed by the terrorists. But they began to feel that these terrorists are their well-wishers. And this psychological term for this is Stockholm syndrome. These captive people thought that, oh, these terrorists can kill us anytime. But the fact that they haven't killed us as yet means they are kind to us. So they are nice to me. So they are right. So let me do what they tell me to do. There are so many instances in this world. You can check it out on the internet. There are so many people who have been abused and held captive by cruel people, but still they fell in love with their captors. This is called Stockholm syndrome. Similarly, we have been abused by the mind. We are held a prisoner and captive by the mind. But because we are not experiencing happiness in surrender to Krishna, we are not surrendering to Krishna, the fact that we are still alive, the fact that we are still carrying on, and the fact that we still have memory of the pleasure that the mind did give us when we lived in the space of sense gratification. Therefore, although we are in the space of struggle, we are wanting, our aspirations are pure, we want to advance in spiritual life, but because we are still trapped by the mind, we suffer from Stockholm syndrome, and we believe our mind's nasty proposals and go back to sense gratification, that very thing which we wanted to give up for Krishna. Therefore, we have no choice. If we have practiced spiritual life for the last few years, we have to take our struggle to the next level, and that is surrender. So in this spirit, let us enter the most important festival of Janmashtami. And I want to end with one very practical thing that you could do to improve your relationship with Krishna. One of my, I would say, friends and acquaintances wrote me an email. This lady is 72 years old, 70 plus. She wrote a letter to me saying how journal writing really changed her life. She said she's experiencing the joy of surrender to Krishna through journal writing. And I'm sharing with you what has helped her. And even I've tried, started doing that, and it is showing me also benefits. She writes 4 letters, not every day. Every day, one of the 4. And this has added new meaning to her life. She writes letters to Krishna. You can't write every day, I agree. But imagine writing a letter to Krishna. He writes a personal letter to Krishna. In fact, I tried this experiment in Bahrain this year in January, first week when I was there. There were 150 devotees and we did a workshop, Japa workshop for them. And I told them Krishna has written a letter to you. And I read out Krishna's letter to them. And then I said, now you have to write a letter to Krishna. And all of them wrote. And then they all gave it to me. And I spent 3 hours in the evening reading all those letters. And they were so beautiful, straight from the heart. And some of these letters, I mean, they are written by unknown devotees, so-called insignificant devotees. And when I was reading those letters, they were like rich, practical Srimad Bhagavatam. They were like lectures of great sannyasis. You know, they're sincere outpourings of a heart that is wanting to love Krishna. So this is the power of writing letter to Krishna. So if you write a letter, you could write anything. Krishna, even if you don't feel the love for the Lord, it's okay. You write, Krishna, who are you? What's happening in my life? You know, I don't believe in you. Why don't you show yourself up to me? What's up in my life? Just write something. Just follow 2 rules. Always ensure that your letter at least ends with some appreciation, some gratitude, some thank you. That has to be there. And second, some hope, some optimism. Some optimism and gratitude has to be there at least a little bit. Otherwise, you can write your heart out. But do write a letter to Krishna. So this is what this lady has done. And she said, it really helped her a lot. Second thing, she writes a letter to her spiritual master, although her spiritual master has left this world. But she feels great joy in writing a letter to her guru. Third, she says she writes a letter to Maya Devi. But she says, I have given a male designation to Maya Devi. Like, because she's from a Christian tradition, so she, like, they also know there is a Satan who is the competitor to God. So for her, it is Mr. Maya. It's her version. But she says it helps her connect to the Lord better. So she writes a letter to Mr. Maya. You know, you have done this in my life. Why do you do this? Blah, blah, blah. So she's writing a letter consciously to Maya, to Krishna, to her guru. And then she said that in her life, she had 2 relationships with 2 men at different times. One relationship lasted for 25 years, another for 20 years. And these men had influenced her or impacted her life in a great way. And they still haunt her to a certain extent. So now she is fully absorbed in devotional service, but sometimes this past comes back to her. So sometimes she writes a letter to these men, although they don't exist, they're not part of her life. In fact, they are dead. One of them is dead already. But she writes a letter like to Mr. Paul, you know, and then she enters that space. She writes a letter from her heart to him and then she tears it off. Although it's a past, although it has got nothing to do with the present life. But she does write a letter. So the point I'm trying to make is writing a letter to the Lord, writing a letter to Krishna is a way we can translate our struggle to surrender. We can make our spirituality from a practical centered approach to a personal approach when we begin with writing letters to the Lord, when we begin by offering a sincere personal prayer to Krishna. So with this humble offering, I thank all of you for attending this 4 sessions on spirituality from practical to personal. And we discussed the examples from Srimad Bhagavatam and the 7th chapter of Gita. And I eagerly look forward to serving you. Thank you very, very much. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Ram, 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 Hare Hare. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna.